Welcome to From the Mezzanine, a motion picture podcast. We are two guys from the Midwest who have a passion for all things film and TV. We are not professional reviewers. We do not trade opinions for special access from movie studios, and our reviews are not on the behalf of any organization or publication that may have a larger agenda. Each week, we put our own money on the line to tell you what is the best and the worst in theaters, on streaming services, and video on demand. We are not here to beg for your donations or sell you men's razors and meal kits. From this point forward, we are talking all things movies and television.
And welcome, everybody. I'm Chuck.
I'm Matt.
Yeah, joined by my buddy Matt here. And we're going to talk about a whole slew of cool things having to do with movies. But just to get us started here, we have to stay on track. That's essential to the task. And, oh, wouldn't you know it? I closed the outline like a goof. Bear with me while I stall us right out of the gate.
I have it open.
You have it open? Thank God. Yeah, because I accidentally closed it. I have so many random things going on.
Yeah, go ahead and pull it back up. But yeah, so the first thing we've got on the docket tonight is movie news, followed by theatrical movies. And then after that, we're going to go into streaming content, followed by the Mentionables. And then our in-depth review tonight is for Spencer. In theaters now, and then we'll tell you what's releasing next week. But the first thing we got on the docket is the Book of Boba Fett trailer, new Disney Plus streaming show.
And that is exactly what I expected it to be. You know, the fact that our boy Boba is back and in force is pretty cool and everything. But how is it going to distinguish itself from The Mandalorian as far as, you know, the storytelling and scope and ambition? Like, it seems a little bit too grounded for, you know, how expansive The Mandalorian proved to be.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, I think they're just treating it as like a continuation, honestly, because The Mandalorian, I think, you know, we know it and Disney knows it, that that's like the most successful thing that they've done when the Star Wars license has been in like their hands, basically. And I'd be fine if it was just a continuation of The Mandalorian, honestly, because I think it's the best thing that Star Wars has done since probably Rogue One. And then before that, probably since Return of the Jedi. But yeah, I don't know. What do you make of it? Did you watch The Mandalorian?
Yes, I did. And okay. And while my vigor and, you know, I guess my investment in Star Wars has diminished with time, I was really taken with that show. And just like the kind of Star Wars that it wanted to be versus what I had been getting. Yeah, like Rogue One, it was very refreshing because it just used the setting and the possibilities and just gave us a different kind of Star Wars experience, you know, versus just the hero's story, you know, the Joseph Campbell shit. You know, there's a little bit more gray here. There's, and also just a great affection for what I loved about Star Wars as a kid, which was all the people in funny suits and makeup, the aliens. And they gave a lot of that. And yeah, and if there ever was a Mandalorian that people identified with, it is Boba Fett. So it's fitting that we're actually just giving him his own damn show.
Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's I'm glad that they're like finally realizing like who to give these properties to, because like Dave Filoni has been relegated to like animated shows for the longest time,
which is really those are all well and good, but it's a waste of his talents.
Yeah, and now they're finally just like, okay, we understand what we have now with you, and so let's give you the keys to the kingdom. Let's give you the live action, you know, huge budget shows. And then on top of that, we've got I looked at the directing page for the show earlier, and we've got episodes directed by Jon Favreau, Dave Filoni, Robert Rodriguez.
Yeah, so the usual suspects.
Yeah, it's going to be cool. And I'm kind of glad that they folded Robert Rodriguez kind of into their little like cadre of filmmakers.
He's a neat guy who typically would never actually get a Star Wars gig. So giving him mercenary work like this is perfect for him at this stage in his career. I was very happy with what I saw in the trailer. Just lots of aliens sitting around tables. It's basically just Deadwood in Star Wars now, which is kind of fun. He even has a woo, you know. That was very unfortunate. I shouldn't have said that. But moving on, next. Now, I'm not so much bringing this up because I'm excited for the movie or the fact that this movie even looks interesting. I am more so very much fascinated with the whole process of world building, especially when you're using tentpole, multi-million dollar films. But Morbius is such a strange little thing, and I kind of probed Bradshaw on this, and it seems to be is just this mishmash of all the different eras of Spider-Man. You know, if you look within the minutiae of the trailer. Mm-hmm. And what this signals going forward for that whole company and that franchise. And I had not realized the intricacies of the complexities of that deal. But Spider-Man basically still belongs to Sony, and they just did Disney a favor by letting them have the character at all. Mm-hmm. You know, is this because they couldn't do anything better? So now that, like, you know, the training wheels are off, they are going full multiverse on this, because this will come up, Leo. This is relevant to another thing we're going to talk about. Yeah, I might as well just, you know, segue right into it, unless you have something particular to say about Morbius.
Yeah, well, I guess here's my theory on it. So, Tom Holland is contractually obligated to do 3 Spider-Man films for the MCU. So here's what I think is going to happen. His third Spider-Man movie comes out this December. And what they're going to do is, once his contract's done with the MCU, Sony's going to snatch up Tom Holland and they're going to put him in this universe where they already have Venom and they already have Morbius. And pretty soon they're going to have Kraven the Hunter. And then I just saw a news story today that Sony has 2 more untitled Marvel movies for 2023. So they're gonna pluck Tom Holland out of the MCU. They're gonna put him in their movies, and then that's what's gonna happen.
Yeah, but we got our boy Michael Keaton here. You know, he's the Vulture.
Yeah,
and he's Batman.
Yeah, I mean, they're it kind of seems like they're ramping up for Sinister Six. You know, honestly,
because that was threatened during the Amazing Spider-Man era.
Yeah.
And luckily we dodged the bullet and we didn't get, oh my God, it would have been great though. God damn it. Not, Paul Giamatti's Rhino.
That was bad.
That man deserved a movie though. Can you imagine how great, like, yeah. if let Werner Herzog direct it? That would have been pretty good.
Yeah. But yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say on that is I think that's what's going to happen. I think it's pretty obvious, but, I guess we'll see.
Yeah. All things, you know, will be revealed with time, you know, because that happened, you know, with you still haven't seen the Eternals yet. You're going tomorrow.
Yep, I'm gonna go. I've got tickets for tomorrow for Monday. So I actually had a funny story. I had tickets for a Wednesday night preview showing, like 5 days ago.
Ooh, how exclusive.
Yeah, they were just like a free. It's basically like a radio show showing. Or like a radio, DJ program showing.
Yeah.
And, I just like couldn't be bothered to go, even though they were free. Like I had free tickets, get a guaranteed like seat. And it was just like, I don't really want to see this. But now after all this, like all this stupid, like this critical, like reaction to this movie, I have to see it. Cause I have to kind of like know what all these people are talking about.
Because like, this is just my take on it. It's eye rolling It's laughably bad at times, you know, technically and just as a superhero movie. I was completely baffled by, you know, quite a bit that I experienced. Like, from what I saw, I must confess, an African man popped up and tried selling me Bitcoin in the middle of whatever stream I was watching. So I'm not exactly sure if I saw everything, and I know I definitely was distracted at times. So if I was held captive by this movie, I know I would have hated it as much as our friend Eric Bradshaw did. And I can't wait to hear what that man has to say, you know, in fullness about it, because I let him hold back in our conversation about it. But the real, you know, takeaway for me, though, you know, in actually understanding what I watched when I saw this, it's infuriating because of what it could have been and what they made with it instead and how lame it is, and and how there's no excuses anymore. This is such a well-oiled machine. There's a lot of rhetoric going around that there's just, you know, hate for a female director making an action movie, you know, just by default. Like, this is just something that, you know, female directors always get when they, you know, are given the job of making, you know, buses disappear into flowers. But they didn't quite nail it, and they just created way too many continuity questions. Mm-hmm. And the special effects are just laughably bad. Like that clip of Angelina Jolie whizzing by there, it is like a PS3 game. and you can see, like, the transition from really bad rushed CGI that was slapped together to work around this global location shooting schedule that they had, instead of the CGI sequence artists directing the movie from afar and writing the movie from afar. Chloe Zhao had too much of a say, basically. Sure. That's my take on it. She wasn't a good fit for this movie. She thought she was doing Terrence Malick, and for moments it seems like she is, and she's kind of, you know, getting that. But it really doesn't hold up, especially when they just start quipping and it's, you know, just another, you know, Joss Whedon comic book script, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, having not seen the movie yet, the way that I'm kind of coming at this story is from the sort of critical reaction to it, like other movie reviewers. Yeah. And I think it's like really, really embarrassing, actually, like how some of these critics are reacting to it, because there was a article posted over at pretty known movie website slashfilm.com.
Yeah.
Basically about how they were defending the movie's low Rotten Tomato score. They were calling it ambitious for, you know, too ambitious for some people is what they were saying. And
yeah, it does not.
They said it was low. And they also said, like, homophobia might have something to do with it. Why people don't like it. And it's really, I don't know, it's just kind of embarrassing, because, like, I think a lot of movie reviewers nowadays they're at the point where they are becoming like brand ambassadors, basically. Mm-hmm. And they're not like critics anymore. And this is kind of what I'll say about it, is like, you should be defending your opinion on a movie, not defending the movie itself.
Yeah.
So yeah, defend your opinion, don't defend the movie. And that's not what people are doing. They're defending this movie like tooth and nail. And I don't know why, like, because I think it represents some like bigger message. And it's just embarrassing, because they're becoming like shills for these mega corporations. And
yeah. And basically this is just Disney padding its corporate, like, social credit score. There's actually like a term for this kind of thing. But you know, they're making all the right moves as far as that kind of posturing is concerned. They aren't screening the movie in certain countries because they were going to be censored. Mm-hmm. You know, and the reality is the audience that this was meant to be received by has received the movie. And any audience that would not you know, would be so offended that they wouldn't go, wasn't going to go anyway at this point. And the reality is that aspect of the movie is actually the only part of it that rings true and feels genuinely felt, you know, honestly, because there's so much of the relationships between the characters is just contrived. Like, oh, we remember when this happened, you know, that kind of bullshit. It's all throwaway. None of it registers. But that's that one aspect of the same sex couple, you know, and it being, oh, this is one of the main line hero characters. Never mind, he's one of like 12, and we barely get to know anything about him beyond the fact that he's gay. You know, mm-hmm. Yeah, like it's a victory if you care about that. But the overall effect is, it's the one thing they developed in the movie with, you know, any real effort behind it. And that's why this movie fails, because they could have put a lot more time and thought into how this movie was edited and presented, because it has a good pedigree. It has a, you know, an Academy Award winning director. It has a really good cinematographer, you know, like most of these movies do. They have great artists working on them, but the collective effort is just so all over the place and unbelievably pedestrian that I was just like, oh my God, like this is the best that they could give me after all this time. This is what they're just pooping this out. Like, what the heck are they? If this is what Eternals is, what is Fantastic Four going to be like? Mm-hmm. But that's the thing. There is some cool elements. Like, there's some cosmic horror in there, which I'm always a little bitch for. It always comes up whenever I see it in something. But the cosmic horror in this just makes the whole affair pointless. Not to, you know, go on too much longer about it. But yeah, definitely go. Yeah, and I can't wait to hear what you actually think about the bullshit that they put you through when you watch this thing.
The other thing too, I just want to touch on real quick, is this movie, more so than any other like Marvel movie, I think it's like really strange and like, I don't know, just almost like perverted how much a lot of critics are focusing on like the sex scene in it. Like, I haven't seen it, so I don't know what it is, but I've been seeing all these articles about how like Marvel's first sex scene is, you know, like it's amazing, like they got a sex scene in a Marvel movie. And it's just like, it's like these are made, at the end of the day, these movies are made for children. And it's like, what the fuck is wrong with you people? Like,
I'm not a
prude, but you know, I'm fine with, you know, movies that have stuff like that. But it's like, what the fuck is wrong with you if you're like cheering for like a PG-13 kids movie to show like two people banging? Like, it's just weird.
Yeah, it is a strange fascination and priority that they have. And it's prevalent across a lot of different media, and you know, it's not, you know, like critics of a lot of different, you know, genres of things.
Mm-hmm.
But the it always does kind of circle back to genitalia and what people are doing with them, and like is becoming the primary concern about whether something should be focused on or talked about. Mm-hmm. You know, it's very reductive, unfortunately.
Yeah, strange.
But, you know, onto something a little bit more interesting. You know, the movie Army of the Dead didn't really have anything to say. You know, it's Zack Snyder. You know, he's just pretty pictures at this point for me. But there was this weird little inexplicable angle to the Army of the Dead, where they insinuate basically that all of these characters are in a time loop, and there's literally corpses of themselves strewn all over the casino from all the different times that they've tried to do this.
Okay.
And apparently in the Army of Thieves, the prequel, you know, directed by the actor who plays the Safecracker.
Mm-hmm.
It is like literally put front and center. It's like the whole point of this prequel movie is to establish more concretely that the time loop happened, and it has something to do with him and the safe he cracked. basically, is because when he shoves that one guy through the door, you know, of the vault, and he shuts it after they open it, you know, at the end of the movie, the theory essentially is that he was the survivor, the I forget the character's name, he has like a Dutch name, but the guy who survives and realizes he's been bitten at the end, he's in a different timeline, is the assumption. So this next movie we're going to be getting, you know, that's going to be following horror movie logic. So if you haven't seen them actually killed on screen, they're not actually dead. And there's just going to be a lot of reappearances of characters who we believe have, you know, been zombified at this point or have been nuked at the very least. I don't know. I'm not sure if this makes me more interested or not, but it just makes me confused about what is the point. And I don't think there is one, unfortunately.
Yeah, I haven't seen the new one yet. I watched Army of the Dead, but I haven't seen the prequel. But I know that there were kind of those theories going around when that first came out. And it's sort of cool that it turned out to be true, because oftentimes these things where people look way too hard into like the lore of movies don't turn out to be true. And it sort of is cool that this one actually is turning out to be true.
Yeah. And they're actually doing something with it, even if because this might be a lost situation where they're just like, well, everyone is assuming it, so we might as well just go with it. Yeah. Sure. Cause it seemed like that's what the writers of that show were doing at times, but this seems a little too planned out. Like this seems like something that, you know, Zack Snyder came up with while he was high on Adderall while editing or, you know, something, and, you know, working on, you know, the Justice League recut, and this is the result, you know. But it just is bizarre to me that Netflix is willing to just give this man all the money to just do this weird thing and to have it be a legit franchise now. Like, were these released in theaters at all, or were they strictly just on Netflix?
They're just Netflix, because I think as far as Netflix goes, the only movies that they actually release in theaters are the ones that they think have any sort of shot of winning awards.
Yeah. Okay.
Because that's the reason why, because you have to be in theaters for like 2 weeks in order to qualify for Oscars. So.
And that is always important, always essential, more so than anything else that happens.
Yeah.
But moving on from news. I saw one other theatrical movie, you know, this week, and it was Antlers, you know, which has been long gestating.
You want to take
thing
off the screen?
My mistake there.
That's okay.
I got to be a better producer here. It's the latest from Scott Cooper, and it has a bunch of familiar faces in it. But the end result is really, really boring. It has like a lot of Nick Antosca stuff. It has good build, and there's lots of ominous, creepy imagery throughout. Lots of blood, which I love. But the plot is basically two meth cooks, you know, basically get bitten by a Wendigo spirit in a cave that they're cooking meth in, and his poor neglected son has to try and survive and keep his father from going too feral by giving him roadkill and shit like that. And Carrie Russell is his teacher. She gets way too involved, you know, because she was an abused, you know, young child as well at one point. Her brother, played by Jesse Clemens, is the sheriff. There's that one actor who always plays a Native American sage in literally everything that you've ever seen, from Twilight to, you know, every Western. I forget the gentleman's name. I think he pops up in the trailer here at some point, but there's lots of good familiar faces, and the monster is, you know, is pretty, you know, interesting once you actually get there, but it just uses shadows way too much to hide a lot of what would be genuinely spooky. And like there's like flashes of brilliance, you know, here and there, but I just by the end of it, I just wanted it to be over. and I just wanted to leave. And and that's my review of Antlers.
Yeah, that's, I mean, it sounds like a Scott Cooper movie. His movies always seem to be like kind of half-baked and sort of like movies that could have been great, but they like fall short, you know? I don't know. Have you ever seen any of his other stuff, like Out of the Furnace or
I think Crazy Heart? Crazy Heart, yeah, because that's the movie that Jeff Bridges got his Oscar for, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, about the country music. I don't really like Out of the Furnace. I think I maybe watched part of it when it was on Netflix at one point, but I didn't get around to actually finishing it. And so this might be the since Crazy Heart, this might be the first of his movies that I've actually finished all the way through. Okay. And you know, the man's competent, but the script is just, it's, there's just an epidemic of scripts that are just half baked Stephen King shit. And and this is just one of those kinds of movies where like it gets greenlit because it's competent horror, but there's nothing really special here. It was not worth the wait. And it got kind of built up for me a little bit too much because of all the Nick Antosca stuff I've been gobbling up since I discovered him over the last few months. But this was pretty marginal, unfortunately. I'm much more excited to talk about some of the streaming content that I got into. But right off the bat, I will throw a plug to the boys at Fargonauts for having me on to watch Dogtooth. That's an old favorite. Bradshaw and I bonded over that when it first came out. But like, what do you think about that movie?
I like it. I think as far as like Yorgos Lanthimos goes, I like him better when he's a little more accessible, like The Favorite and like Killing of a Sacred Deer.
Yeah,
I mean that's a pretty messed up movie, but this one's still pretty good. I like it a lot. It's really weird and it's very Greek.
Yeah, it's so. Yeah, off-putting and bizarre, and it takes like a conversation to understand it while you're watching it. Mm-hmm. And it's not a movie you recommend to people because it's kind of an endurance movie. At some point, the people will tap out. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot that happens in it, but the elevator synopsis is: what if you never let your children grow up? Like you were so afraid of the world that you crafted an experience and a worldview for your children, so all that they know is the reality you present to them. And even if they're adults, you don't let them grow up. That's the basic pitch about the film. Really, really, really good though. But like you say, it's not as most accessible. I think this one was nominated for like the best foreign film Oscar at the time, but it definitely was not mainstream. But it's what got him all of his more mainstream accessible work to get seen. Like this movie had an impact, so
for sure.
So if people are at all into that or interested in that, they should seek that out. But yeah, definitely check out Fargonauts. Those guys are the best, and they really push out a lot of content, and they're an inspiration.
You want to just in case anybody doesn't know how to spell that, you want to spell that real quick?
Oh goodness. Fargonauts.
Yep, pretty sure that's what it is.
Yeah, up next we're gonna talk, like, did you get a chance to look up Spine of Night?
No, I mean, I know what it is. I know of it, but I haven't been able to watch it yet. I've got it kind of queued up on my wish list on Vudu to rent, but no, I haven't seen it.
It's worth it. Yeah, definitely do. It's really impressive for what it is. And My experience with rotoscoping goes back to the Ralph Bakshi Lord of the Rings when I was a kid. Like, that's my definitive Lord of the Rings movie, is the one that he made. And this is very inspired by, like Conan the Barbarian, you know, and other Robert E. Howard stuff. But it the origin of it is really fascinating, because it's for like the last 10 years, these guys have just been putting out like proof of concept works, you know, like on YouTube, like Exodia is one. And then there's like Mongrel versus the Ape King or something like that. And it has a pretty good voice cast. But there are a few moments that look like bad episodes of Archer, unfortunately. But for the most part, really, really good. And, you know, the animation and everything is really spectacular. Really good soundtrack, too.
Yeah, I definitely am interested in watching it. That short film, if anybody's interested in like what this kind of is like, they do have their short film on YouTube right now. I think it's only 8 minutes, and it's all up there for free on their official channel. So
yeah, and it's actually a really good prequel experience for what the actual story of Spine of Night is. It sets everything up. It's really, really neat, actually. Like, and so as a proof of concept, you know, to get this movie made, it worked, because it's basically like it's a good prequel. For 8 minutes, they should have just put it at the beginning of this. But this is such a complete and crafted experience that I understand that why it was separate. So, yeah, that was The Spine of Night. Pretty good stuff. And what were you able to watch this week, Matt?
Yeah, so as far as streaming stuff goes, so I just want to touch on this quick. What We Do in the Shadows Season 3 just ended on FX on Hulu. And that show continues to be pretty great. It's one of the funniest shows that's out right now. Season 3 is a little bit more kind of hit or miss than the first two seasons. And I think it kind of has something to do with them trying to progress the story a little more. Mm-hmm. The first two seasons were a little bit more like contained episodes, you know, Monster of the Week type stuff. With season 3, they kind of went like really, really big on like the carrying storylines over from each episode to each episode. But the one thing that I noticed, maybe if you watch this, you'll notice too, that the better episodes are actually directed by Kyle Newacek. Are you familiar with him? Do you know who he is?
That name is familiar to me. It's ringing a bell, but like what has he made?
So Kyle Newacek's most known for being like the fourth member of like the Workaholic guys. He pretty much directed every episode of Workaholics, and he wrote all the episodes with those guys.
Yeah, I forget who he plays in the show. But
he's in the show too.
Yeah, okay, no, that's really neat. Okay.
Yeah, so he's actually directed a lot of episodes of this show in the other seasons too, and his episodes are always really great. They're the funnier ones. And then the other director that did episodes this season was a director named, Yana Gorski. And it seems like they kind of just gave her like the more story oriented episodes, and they're just like less funny. It's just, they're not as good.
Cause they can't be about the bits. She has to do all the heavy lifting.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. And it kind of is a slog to get through sometimes, but they ended the show on a really good place, and they've already confirmed, I think, a fourth and a fifth season. And they actually are going to really change it up in the next season. They're finally getting them out of their like mansion in New Jersey, because all three seasons have been set in like the same location, and it was kind of getting a little old, but they're really changing it up for the next season. And so I'm really excited for that, but yeah, I just wanted to touch on that. And then I also watched The Harder They Fall on Netflix. that is a Western, and it's pretty standard as far as Westerns go. It has some pretty cool like directorial flair. The guy who directed it, I'm forgetting his name right now, but he directed a Jay-Z music video and like pretty much nothing else.
And yeah, they say he was like a part of the brain trust on The Great Gatsby. Like he did all the music videos for that movie, you know, because okay, Jay-Z sure. did the music for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, yeah, I mean, it's a lot of like directorial flair, like a lot of freeze frames and slow motion and like splitting the screen down the middle and showing one thing on one side and then one thing on the other. That type of stuff, and like syncing like gunshots up with like musical cues and stuff like that.
It's pretty good stuff. Cool.
Yeah, it's pretty cool in that respect. But yeah, and it's the first half is kind of slow because it's kind of one of those movies where it's like, you know, I'm putting together a team sort of thing. And so the first half's kind of them putting together the team, and then the second half is like pretty much like balls to the wall, like gunfights and shootouts, and it's pretty cool. But yeah, that one's pretty good. And then let's see, what else did I do? Oh yeah, and then there was a couple other stuff I wanted to just really touch on really fast because they're really not worth spending a whole lot of time on.
Yeah.
The Forgotten Battle on Netflix. That is a Dutch movie. It's actually the second most expensive Dutch movie that they've like ever made. And the first is Paul Verhoeven's Black Books.
I remember that movie. That's at the standard.
What's that?
That movie was the most expensive one.
Yeah, that's the most expensive Dutch movie ever made. So yeah. I think because of the talent probably, but it's not really that like impressive of a movie. But this is very impressive. The budget was only $16 million, and it's a war movie, World War II movie, and it looks fantastic for that type of movie. You know, it looks very, very good as far as all the set dressing and like getting everything period appropriate. And it's kind of one of those movies where three timelines sort of converge. It follows a British soldier, a German soldier, and then like a Dutch resistance fighter. Mm-hmm. And their sort of paths converge at the end of the movie. But it's pretty standard. I mean, it's the type of movie that like your dad's going to like.
Yeah.
So
chances are I'd probably like it too. I should give that a watch.
Yeah, you should. It's pretty good. And then, The Invasion on Apple TV Plus, that's a new show. I think there's 6 episodes out now. Don't watch it. It's pretty garbage. This is done by Simon Kinberg.
Oh, you know, no. Yeah. I know that motherfucker. Yeah. God damn
he's
it.
He's pretty bad. And this show is, you know, hypothetically, it's about an alien invasion. But here's the thing. The alien invasion actually never comes. They just hint at it the entire show. And it's really, really boring. And it's really, really tedious. And that's really all I have to say about it. Like, it's...
Because, like, what is Apple thinking? Because I'll bump in quick just to, like, because... I'm really impressed with Foundation. I watched the first episode or two of that.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Holy shit. That's really fucking good. Yeah, and
it's great.
Like, that has some, like, blow-your-wad cinema moments, you know, in it. Like, it makes the argument for Dune should have been on TV instead of in theaters, actually. Denis Villeneuve, you're wrong. Yeah, because Apple can do that shit. So why is Invasion so lame, then? Because they obviously have unlimited resources.
Yeah, they have the money, but this seems like a show that should have been on like NBC. Like that's
network TV.
Like La Brea. Have you heard of La Brea?
That is that just like the is it the time travel involved? Are people going back in time? Are there dinosaurs? Like that's my impression of La Brea.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty bad. So don't watch it. I actually stopped after the 4th episode, and I think there's like 6 out now, and I'm not going to keep watching it. But, and then the last thing I was going to touch on for the streaming section was Finch, also on Apple TV Plus. And we had mentioned this one last week at the end of the show. And it's from Miguel Saponik, I think is how you say his last name. And I'll say again, he's kind of the guy who did all the huge Game of Thrones episodes. And I don't think he really makes the transition to like filmmaker very well. It's a pretty standard movie, post-apocalypse story with Tom Hanks. He's the only human character in the whole movie. You never actually ever see another human character. It's just him and then a robot.
That he's training. And the robot,
training a robot to basically take care of his dog once he dies. And the robot's voiced by Caleb Landry Jones. And he's pretty good. The robot's very realistic looking. The CG is really, really good on that. And it's kind of okay. I mean, it's nothing special. And, some of the CG is a little dodgy at some places. And you can tell it was probably made like during COVID. And
yeah, COVID caused an epidemic of bad, movie effects. You saw that in Eternals particularly.
Okay.
To circle back to that, to reinforce what you're saying.
But yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say about it. I mean, if you want to watch it, I can't really recommend it or not recommend it. It's fine, I guess.
Yeah,
all I have to say.
It's worth, wasting your time on a Saturday night with.
Yeah. It's a good like time waster movie or like a movie to watch with like your family or something, because there's really nothing like that objectionable in it. Like
it's good holiday fare.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, people like Wally. This is basically just Wally with Tom Hanks, who people also love.
Pretty much.
So this is basically like my Mentionables is basically just another streaming recommendation. Since Netflix has decided that they are going to be your one stop for JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, and the latest season of that is going to be, being released stateside simultaneously with Japan. So they're localizing it in real time for once, because they finally have put Golden Wind on Netflix with the English dub, which I know a lot of people need, and I'm just happy that I can actually find it at all. But I love this show for no good reason. I don't really watch anime, but JoJo's Bizarre Adventure just really has this weird, goofy sensibility. And I just love how distinctive the art style is and how completely dopey the writer and creator is. He's such a goof. And none of you cannot take this seriously. It's just it's just a good time. It served as an inspiration for a lot of different things, though. Like Persona apparently was lifted almost wholesale in some aspects.
Okay.
But the premise of Golden Wind is the most fun, because it's the son of the mainline villain is the main character. He's the JoJo, because each season basically reinvents itself, and that's another reason why the show is appealing. And in this season, the main character is an Italian gangster who is working with a bunch of other gangsters to try and clean up the mafia to get them out of the drug business. That's the premise.
Okay.
And they have these special powers called stands, where like their fighting spirit is represented in some form, and they all have weird little like quirks and angles to them. So it's like Digimon or Pokemon on that on that level. But if you like anime and just want something goofy, this is a very basic, recommendation to make. It's pretty basic bitch as far as weeboo content is concerned. But I like it, so I'm going to recommend Golden Wind since it's on Netflix now.
All right, and then speaking of sort of anime or Japanese adjacent things, this week I started reading Censor by Junji Ito, famed Japanese horror manga artist and writer. And are you familiar with him at all?
Yes, I am. I've flirted with reading Uzumaki many times. I've never actually pulled the trigger.
Okay. Yeah. That's the one to read. That that's his masterpiece. That's my favorite of his. I think it's one of like the best mangas. I mean, I haven't read that much manga, but I think it is a masterpiece. So if you're going to read something of his, read that one. This one is definitely not one to start with, because Censor is, it's less horror and it more flirts with sort of like existential stuff, like existential questions and like religious themes and stuff like that. I know a lot of people, when they read through this, like a lot of Junji Ito fans read through this and they were kind of pissed because there's very little horror in it. And it's very like mystery. It's more of a mystery. There is some like scenes where things get pretty weird, but it's not horror at all. And it's definitely not one to start with, but I'm pretty much all the way through it. It's all one story too. It's not one of his short story compilations. It's one big story like Uzumaki. And I would recommend it overall, but don't start with this if you've never read Junji Ito, because it's not going to be the one to get you into his stuff. So
yeah, I've seen, you know, a lot of his imagery. You know, it's very indelible and it's all over the internet, you know. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to have to be able to pull the trigger someday just to be a completionist. But there was a quote, like a side-by-side meme. Who knows how accurate it actually is. But one side is, what's his name? The Studio Ghibli guy.
Oh, Miyazaki?
Miyazaki, from that documentary about him where he's like, fuck, I hate the Beatles. The Beatles are the worst. And then there's a cut to Junji Ito saying, I fucking love the Beatles. They're my favorite band. And they're just so completely different artistically.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, it's good though. Yeah, definitely though, read Uzumaki. That one's great.
Spirals spinning on and on. Oh, what the heck? Okay. But this week, we both went to our local theater to check out Spencer. And what can you tell me about that movie?
Spencer, yeah. So yeah. Spencer is it's 3 days in the life of Princess Diana. I believe it is set over Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, and Boxing Day of 1991. And it's set at one of their estates. I'm not sure what the estate was called, but
Sandringham or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And she's kind of with the royal family, and this is kind of where she was sort of starting to gain a lot of like attention from like the paparazzi and stuff. And the royal family was kind of shunning her a little bit, I think, at this point. And her husband was cheating on her. But yeah, I guess kind of first off, spoiler-free impressions. I really like this. I think Kirsten Stewart, her performance is incredible, like incredible performance. And I like the movie a lot overall. If I have any sort of complaints, it would be, I think there was like one too many scenes that kind of treaded over the same ground where it's like, okay, we get it. You're miserable. Like, let's do something else now. Mm-hmm. And they get there by the end. But I liked it a lot overall.
As did I. As I've consumed a lot of content around the royal family, like The Crown, and like I'm always a sucker, you know, for stories about these people. So like I enjoyed this one because they very much are absent. You know, they are window dressing because Kristen Stewart is the focus. Unless they have something useful to say, you know, or to like a foil to play to, you know, her experience, they're just not there. And the movie is not concerned at all about giving us any awareness of like who is who and what do they think about what's going on. The one thing I loved about this movie was how half the time it's just her in a bathroom, you know, and just like an agony on the floor. Like half of the movie is her just doing that, because we weren't exposed to any of the bullshit. Like this for it being about the Christmas weekend, they don't spend a lot of time amongst the royal family doing royal family bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it does unfortunately kind of just tread water for a while, you know, just, you know, churning on the same shit over and over again. You know, all of, like, how many different scenes with the help does she need to have? Because like, I do like upstairs, downstairs movies. That's a genre that I enjoy, you know, like Gosford Park and the like, and that's ultimately why I like royal family stuff. But there was just too much of it. She spent more time with the help than with anybody else.
Yeah. Hey, yeah. You want to grab the video?
Oh, shoot. Sorry. I didn't realize. House of Gucci.
started up. Yeah. I really like the stuff with the help, especially the stuff with like Sean Harris. That stuff was really good. Kind of him playing that chef that is sort of on her side, but then he's also kind of, you know, whispering stuff into her ear that you can kind of tell is from like the royal family. Like, you don't really know whose side he's playing, unlike Sally Hawkins' character.
Mm-hmm.
So I liked all his stuff. And then I really liked the stuff with what's his name?
Timothy Spall.
He
was excellent.
Like the sort of babysitter, basically.
Yeah, he's like the Blackwater guard. You know, he's one of the old, you know, reliables, the guys that they bring out when they need to find the dirty diaries with all of the dirty secrets that the press are looking for. Mm-hmm. So he's been called in to make sure that the curtains are literally, you know, like pinned shut so that nobody could sneak a photo of her. Now, Sean Harris was excellent, but the question of, yeah, like what role was he really playing is a fascinating one, because the beginning of this movie is very deceptive. And I loved that about it, because it is very unclear. It was unclear to me if I was in the right theater for a second, because I was like, wait a minute, why are there soldiers? Why do I feel like why are they clearing a building?
Yeah, and, the ammo cases. Yeah, the giant like artillery cases
that are just
food in them.
It's great. Yeah, it's because that is the reality. Like these people's existences is a military operation. Even like the running of his kitchen, he spoke to his cooks like they were soldiers. You know, because like, well, even though it's not just a gimmick, like it's probably quite real. And the one thing that, yeah, like Sally Hawkins, it was a nice little, you know, contribution to the whole experience. But yeah, like her whole purpose is to, you know, push Diana to just think about herself, you know, and her own happiness and well-being, like to just not subject herself to this anymore, basically, because ultimately that's what ends up happening, you know, in the actual story. But this whole experience is more psychological. It's almost a horror movie at times. Like the specter of Anne Boleyn is literally planted in her head by Timothy Spall's character, because he leaves a book by her bedside very deliberately to send her a message. Because that's how the royal family do shit. You know, nothing is direct. You know, everything is polite. And then they're like gutting you in the back, you know, in between, you know, coffee and supper or whatnot.
Mm-hmm. How did you feel about the, well, I know one thing that a lot of people take issue with is sort of the fantastical elements of the movie, because at the very beginning, it makes it very clear. I can't remember, what does it say exactly? It says a fable based on a true story.
Yes, that's what it is.
Something like that. Yeah, so there are things in this movie that explicitly did not happen, like a sort of hinted at lesbian relationship with Sally Hawkins' character, and the scene, the sort of like schizophrenic stuff, like her like seeing ghosts, and like, you know, none of that stuff happened, or it wasn't documented at least. And some people have taken issue with that. I didn't really have a problem with it because it made it very clear what it was doing. And, but I'll tell you, the lady who was sitting behind me fucking hated it. Holy crap. There was a lady who, like, the second the movie was over, she was like, well, that was dumb. It's
like, I had a much different crowd in my theater. There was like a community options like, you know, gentleman there with his minders and his minders' girlfriends, and they were talking uproariously, and they got really hushed when that happened.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. And it was just like, really? This is the thing that's going to shut you up? Like, this movie's almost over. But that didn't really... Yeah, the whole experience is supposed to not be taken literally. Like, but unfortunately for people who are obsessed with this thing, this particular Christmas that is portrayed is pivotal in the mythos. So they might have take issue with it because they think, well, how can these filmmakers say that these events actually happened and inspired reality? You're like, you know, like influenced, you know, and resulted in the reality we experienced. And that's not what this movie's trying to do. Because no. I suppose we should now bring up the other portrayals, you know, that we could, you know, put this to, because not only as a movie, but as an actor's performance, as an actress's performance, it stands out. Because in The Crown, she's just presented as this bubbly little waif. And while they do explore her, you know, trauma and angst, you know, to varying degrees, they stop short of really showing, you know, how thinly worn her psyche could potentially have been by the whole affair. Whether she was schizophrenic is irrelevant, because it's just more so about what is the catharsis experience that this character is supposed to be going through. What could they possibly have her build up to? And it's, no, I'm taking my kids away from this, you know, shooting range where we're killing pheasants, and we're gonna get the fuck away from you people and go to KFC in London. You know, like, so her priorities aren't about, you know, saving the birds, but it's about saving herself, because there's lots of symbolism about her being just a rooster that is just being paraded out, you know, for her own demise. And that moment at the end, sorry to spoil that for anybody, it, like, where she, like, swoops in front of the firing line, I laughed uproariously at that, because it just took me out of the movie for a second, because I was like, this is insane. But then I had to, like, talk myself down, because I was like, it's okay, this is not real. This did not, they're not saying this actually happened. But for the character in this movie, she needed to do that. She needed to, you know, stake her claim to her own agency, because that is what this movie does kind of drive home, though, is how completely these people must exist within the delusions of Queen Elizabeth, you know, and her desires and wants, and, like, everything must be tuned to her. And if you're not tuned to her, if you have any dissonance that you're guilty of, you're a problem. And yeah, ultimately this movie succeeds for me, because it does reflect reality, and that's exactly what she ended up doing as an actual human being.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I will say, you had touched on, Emma Corrin, I believe is her name, on The Crown playing Diana. And I'll kind of touch on, have you seen the Princess Diana movie with Naomi Watts?
I missed it, because the trailer I saw for it just made me go, oh, they just want to make this woman a saint. And I know that she's got warts, and I'm glad that this movie that we did get, that we just saw, was okay with the warts that she has, to an extent.
Yeah, what I will say, I have seen that movie. I haven't seen The Crown, so it's good that you touched on that one, because I'll touch on this one. Naomi Watts' portrayal in that movie is very much a caricature or an impression. It's somebody trying to, like, emulate exactly, and it just comes off as almost like an impression that, like, a comedian would do, sort of, but not comedic.
The SNL performance.
Yeah, exactly. But with this movie, I think Kristen Stewart was, like, perfectly cast, because, I mean, she doesn't exactly look like Diana. She looks enough like her that it doesn't take you out of the movie, but she's not doing an impression. She's, like, inhabiting the character.
And she's like, she's probably putting out some lived experience too. Because like, honestly, her whole celebrity life has probably been very similar in certain areas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that was, yeah, I to say again, I mean, she was amazing. Like, there's that scene, I think my favorite scene in the movie was the scene where they're at dinner and she rips the pearl necklace off and then starts eating it out of the soup.
That shit fucked me up. That was really good. That was
was good. And yeah, that scene was great. And then just to touch on it real quick, the thing that also made that scene great was the music. And the music in this movie was done by Johnny Greenwood from Radiohead.
Old Reliable. He's put out a lot of good scores.
Yeah, he's done a lot of Paul Thomas Anderson movies. And then he also did, I think, the score for, what was it called? That one, You Were Never Really Here, the Joaquin Phoenix movie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's funny.
He did the score for that, too. The movie about like human traffickers.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that one. Oh. Yeah. God damn.
So, he did that one, too.
I have to watch that movie again.
Mm-hmm.
I'm reminded of that now. That was a good one.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was great. I mean, he kind of shuffles between like a really, really cool, like jazzy score. And then when the movie gets intense, it kind of switches over to like a string quartet sort of like really, really string heavy, like horror music, basically.
It reminded me, you know, of the Black Swan soundtrack, who did that again? What was that gentleman's name?
Oh,
Clint Mansell.
Clint Mansell, yeah.
Yeah, like it was reminiscent of that, especially when it got all stringy like that.
Yep. Yeah. And similar themes too, or similar character even. But yeah, that was great.
Of the mania setting in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it really did seem like a complete film for me. You know, like this was the framing of it, you know, having it take place over those days, having that structure. You know, it had almost a theatrical element to it, even though so many moments were, you know, visually surreal. But how does this compare to Jackie for you?
Yeah, so Jackie was Pablo Loraine's previous movie to this. And it's very similar. You know, famous woman meanders around in a state for 2 hours, I guess, is if you want to be completely reductive about it. That's pretty much what both these movies are. And Jackie is, I think I like Spencer better, because in Jackie, which stars Natalie Portman as Jackie Kennedy, she's playing it a lot more broad than Kristen Stewart did, where it borders on melodrama, and she's in hysterics for a lot of the movie. And it's not necessarily bad, because I mean, her husband just died, because the movie's set like immediately after JFK was assassinated. And it kind of calls for that type of performance. But I think that Kristen Stewart did a lot. She did a lot better and a more like nuanced performance than Natalie Portman did. But otherwise, they're very, very similar movies. But I think this one had a better script, better score, and better lead performance. And that's kind of what I look at it from.
Yeah, it actually had a point to make. Jackie just seemed like grief porn.
Yeah, it's Jackie's much more of like a biography.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even though, like, in retrospect, because it's centered around an interview, right? Like, that was the whole point of that movie. So he does kind of work within the same paradigm with both of them. But this one is more of its own movie, as opposed to just being a slavish portrayal, you know, of an individual. They actually, mm-hmm. like, got inside her head and soul and, like, the zeitgeist of that moment a little bit more.
Yeah, for sure.
No, overall, I was, you know, quite taken with it, and it could have been, you know, the sort of experience where I would have wished that, you know, they had just put it on streaming instead of in a theater, but you know, it was fun being captive, you know, in that setting, and just, you know, being really unsure of what kind of an angle they were going to take with it towards the end.
Yeah, it was great. I really liked it. I think this one's gonna gonna wind up on my top of the year list, sort of. But yeah, I mean, that's pretty much everything I have to say about it. Is there anything else you wanted to touch on?
Just lastly, just a shout out of appreciation to Stephen Knight, you know, as the screenwriter here, because I think he's why this movie succeeds. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and why it had so much to work with, because you have a British man, you know, coming to well-trod territory at this point, and, you know, making a solid rebuke, you know, to the crown, which is, you know, a time-honored tradition for all, you know, British gentlemen, even if they are members of the order, as he is. You know, he's been knighted at this point, because he's got a prolific career and a lot of really cool, you know, things behind him, but the variety is actually kind of staggering when you look back on it. And this seemed like an odd choice for him when I first heard about it, but now it just makes complete sense, because for some reason his perspective on, you know, Britain today and British, you know, history, he's pretty astute, and I'm glad that he was the one behind this, because I feel like he can take a lot of the credit for it working.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, his script was great, and he, yeah, I mean, I honestly, I wasn't like, I've seen a lot of his movies, but I didn't know him by name before I watched this. And I went and I looked up his like IMDb page, and I was like, wow, this guy's like, all the stuff he's written has such varying quality. Cause it's like, I'm looking at it right now, and there's like, the show Taboo.
Yeah.
And he was also like the creator of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
That like, blew my mind. I was like, so that's where he started, is with that.
Yeah. And then like he wrote Eastern Promises, and
which is an awesome fucking movie. Dirty Pretty Things.
Yeah. Dirty Pretty Things. And then he's also written Trash. Like, he did, he does that Apple TV Plus show C, which is supposed to be pretty bad. And then he also did that. Do you remember that movie Serenity with Matthew McConaughey and Anne Hathaway?
Yeah, a batshit insane. So like, so bad, it's like only going to be bad sort of a movie.
Yeah.
No idea where that thing came from.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cause yeah. Like when he hits, and when he misses, it's spectacular trash.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, the, not to like digress here too much, but do you know what the twist is in that movie?
If I remember correctly, it's something to do with, like, I guess I don't really know, but I know that like something isn't real. Like someone is a character in someone's head.
Yeah. So like the whole movie, one of the characters, I can't remember which, one of the characters has like an autistic son, and it turns out like the whole movie was taking place in his head, and he like invented the like world of the movie.
So it's a scene elsewhere.
Yeah, pretty much.
God damn,
it's crazy.
What the hell? They let people do all kinds of things, because that sounds like the kind of script that got hot when like that. What was it called? It's like Dear Henry or something like that, where that lady's son, like
Book of Henry,
the Book of Henry, like
Book
like,
of Henry.
Like,
yeah.
It seems like one of those scripts that like that someone in Hollywood was quite taken with, but should have never, you know, realized.
Yeah, for sure.
But this is a good one. Like this was, when I saw that he was doing this, I was like, oh, this is probably going to be one of his trash, because sometimes he does Locke, where it's really, you know, creative and artsy. And other times, yeah, it's Serenity, which is just nonsense. And it's like, what the fuck? Where did this come from? And there's some borderline moments in Spencer, but he pulls it off. And then Pablo Loraine, more specifically, with Stewart, and because the cast is wonderful. Mm-hmm. Everyone involved did a good job, from what I can say.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah.
But releasing next week, on November 12th, we have Disney Plus Day. What is that?
Yeah, so Disney Plus Day, it's kind of this day that they're like hyping up this year, where they're basically just releasing a bunch of stuff. I know like one of the things is Shang, that's when they're dropping Shang-Chi on Disney Plus, and then also the Jungle Cruise movie. I know like the second season of that Jeff Goldblum show, that documentary series that he does, where it's basically just Jeff Goldblum like going around and like being Jeff Goldblum around stuff.
It's Anthony Bourdain's, you know, you know, since we don't have him, we have Goldblum doing it now.
Yeah, pretty much. And then I know that they're dropping a bunch of shorts that day too. I think they're dropping like a new Simpsons short, and then a short that I don't know if you ever saw Luca, the most recent Pixar movie.
Yes, I did.
Yeah, they're dropping a new Luca short that day too.
Right on.
Yeah, that's coming out. And then Passing. Are you familiar with that?
That's that movie that. God, I did see something about it, but I'm somewhat familiar with the source material. It's about a black woman passing as white in London, right?
Yeah, it's actually Rebecca Hall's directorial debut.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
and it stars I think her name's what's the woman from Thor 3 who played Valkyrie? Tessa Thompson. Tessa Thompson, and then the woman from. Preacher Ruth Negga, I think is what her name is.
Yep. She was in Loving, that movie.
Yeah, Loving. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they play women in London who are like their complexion is like light enough that they can pass as like white people, basically.
Yeah.
And that's supposed to be pretty good. I've heard good things about that. And then Red Notice, which is like a shitty like rock Gal Gadot Ryan Reynolds movie that Netflix just I guess invested in,
because on its face those three names should put asses in seats, right? You know, you would,
yeah,
one would
presumably
think. Yeah.
I'm sure the movie was like a $30 million movie and like half that budget went to their fucking salaries, like,
because I have a feeling it's going to be another one of those movies where we're going to be like, what the fuck was wrong with the special effects in 2020 and 2021? Like, what the fuck went wrong?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. For sure.
It looks all of those kinds of movies look really cheap, you know, like around the edges, because all the money went into the pockets of the stars. But then, there's also going to be. I saw the trailer for this ahead of Spencer, but this is Kenneth Branagh's latest film.
Right? Yeah, Belfast.
Yeah.
Yeah, Belfast. It's I think it's sort of semi autobiographical because I think he grew up there.
Yeah, he's.
If I'm not mistaken,
he's a Northern Irish boy. Yes.
Yeah. So that one's getting a lot of award buzz, I think. And I mean, I don't know much about it. I'll probably see it eventually, but it's not something I'm too interested in. And then
my mom would love that movie, you know, so.
Yeah, for sure. And then Tick, Tick, Boom, which is the biography about Jonathan Larson, the creator of Rent.
Yeah.
The guy who created Rent.
Andrew Garfield.
Andrew Garfield, directed by Lin-Manuel Miranda. And then finally, one last thing to touch on. Next Saturday is the premiere of Blade Runner Black Lotus, which is the new Blade Runner anime that's going to be on Adult Swim. I'm definitely going to be watching that one.
Do we have any awareness of if it is after 2049 or if it's before that, like, Or doesn't it really not matter where in the timeline it fits?
I think I know it's in. I've heard it's in continuity. I don't know exactly when, but it's not. This isn't like a thing where they're like, you know, like, oh, this is its own thing. It's actually in continuity with both the movies, from what I've heard.
Right on.
So that's cool. That's next week, and I'm really interested in that one. As far as next week goes, just to kind of touch on this real quick, we're going to be doing something a little different because we kind of took a look at the movies and both decided that we're not really like too interested in anything coming out. So next week we're going to try a new segment that I guess we'll dub From the Mezzanine Special Segment.
Special segment. Yeah.
And basically, We'll throw these in every now and then whenever it's kind of a week where the releases are a little lighter, where it's kind of like, you know, there's nothing really coming out. And so what we're going to do this next week is because of the popularity of like Korean film and TV over the past, I guess ever since Parasite, but specifically since like Squid Game and then like Dr. Brain on Apple TV Plus, it seems like people are much more into Korean cinema, or they're much more open to watching that type of stuff. And so we're going to do, I guess, like a crash course in Korean film, where Chuck's going to choose three movies and then I'm going to choose three movies. And what this is going to be is sort of our three movies that we think somebody who is not familiar with Korean film should watch. And that definition can vary, you know, kind of how we want it to. It can be the three most important movies that we think to watch, the three most influential, the three most accessible, the three, just three of our favorites, you know, whatever. So that's kind of what we're going to do next week. Is there anything that you wanted to say about it, Chuck?
Or? I'm just looking forward to it because I've long been evangelizing Korean cinema, just Southeast Asian cinema in general, but they specifically have long had really important work, you know, coming out of that peninsula. And I, yeah, really look forward to, you know, cause I still haven't quite nailed down how I'm going to, you know, choose my picks, but I look forward to doing that. Cause it's after Parasite happened, there were a lot of people who were like, hey, what should I watch? Mm-hmm. And it is kind of hard to say because they are an intense, you know, cinema culture. They don't even like they're like, quote unquote, like low key content is still like really in your face and, you know, really hard to just kind of articulate. Like they're an in your face cinema culture, and you can't just say, oh yeah, if you like this kind of Western film, you may not have anything in Korean film for you. But there's definitely, you know, a lot of experiences that are worth having. And I'm going to have to think long and hard about what I'll recommend, because some films I've recommended to people and regretted it because they had such an awful time with it. But maybe people are more open to that kind of thing now.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So yeah, look out for that next week. Should be streaming again, I think Sunday night, and then show up on YouTube a little bit later. But yeah, you want to handle the outros, Chuck? Or?
Yeah, thank you once again. You can find you know, Matt Miller on his Facebook page. It will be in the description. It's where he posts his reviews shortly after he sees, you know, the movies. And you know, this week, I don't know. Are you going to be typing anything up, or are you just got to be saving it for the pod?
Well, I'm going to be, depending on what I see, I mean, I think I might go to Tick Tick Boom this week, because actually I will probably be going to it because my brother-in-law is actually involved in that movie.
Oh, right on. That's really cool.
Yeah, so he's a like a dance teacher out in LA, and so he actually did like a lot of the like choreography for that movie. So we're going to go see that in theaters, because my wife wants to see it. So I'll probably write up something about that on Facebook this week, but
right on.
Yeah, other than that, just look out. I usually post one or two reviews a week on Facebook, just to kind of keep it manageable. But
yeah, otherwise I might do another midnight ramble next Saturday. That's kind of become the habit from me lately as I've gotten into producing this content over the last few weeks. I'm very grateful to have the opportunity. Thank you all for joining us. Look forward to next week's show. Stay safe and have a good one.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.